Oh, got a new light. Yeah, I carry it in my pocket every day. A little moonlight setting. Okay, medium. Turbo. Oh, an attacker. Strobe. Do we need to put a seizure warning at the beginning now?
This is Kirk's little thing now, which looks pretty great, but I can't show it just yet.
Heads or tails? Oh, it sounds good. Have they seen these before where you pull it off and throw it back on? Happens fast.
I learned how to do this in English class. They were all reading like poetry and books, and I was like, yo, the ring roll must be completed. Come on, that's not easy to do.
You know what's also not easy to do? That.
What's up, everybody? Peter McKinnon here. Welcome back to yet another video. And today we're diving in to a behind the scenes shoot for a pretty large client, a project that I did for them that's finally been released. So I can talk about it now. There's a lot to learn. What is it, you ask? It's when Kirk and I went to Saskatchewan to hang out with Can-Am, David Ostacruiser, that crazy off-road guy that has a giant quad that sounds like a beast out of hell. And we shot the commercial and the little ad spots for the new Commander XMR. I should just start by showing you it. So here is the little 20-second off-road live-in Commander XMR ad spot vignette. Check it out. Here it is. It's 20 seconds, man. You'll be right back. I work hard every day for a working man's pay, but I'm letting loose tonight. I think I'm gonna rise up. Pretty cool. So then Can-Am saw that and we're like, hey, can you make like a 60 second version of that that shows a little more X, Y, and Z, throw some text on it, bang. And here is a 60 second extended version of said vignette. When the sun goes down on the river, it's time to chase the moonlight. I work hard every day.
So there you have it. So the first thing with this little ad, we were there for 3 days shooting for 20 seconds. That's the one thing I had to continue telling myself over and over was don't overshoot this because you literally only need 20 seconds. Now, it was after the fact the brand came back and said, can you make a 60 second version because we liked the 20 so much, can you extend it? That's where my overshooting tendencies came in handy because I had more clips that I could add to it that I didn't have time for in the 20 second slot. So that was beneficial. But I did have in the back of my mind, Kirk as well, not to overshoot this project because it was only 20 seconds long. I have two schools of thought on that. Sometimes I like having the extra footage. If a client does come back, if I want to go back and find stuff for a reel or for a video, for overlays, I want to look for photos. I like being able to have a huge selection of things to choose from, maybe even beyond what I didn't use for a professional ad once it had been released. Now, if I didn't shoot enough,
if I would only have what I needed for that 20 seconds and that's it. If the client came back, if I needed to reference something, there would be nothing. So I don't ever feel comfortable doing that. And I don't feel comfortable overshooting to the point where it's just wasted memory, because drive space is expensive. If you have a giant RAID, cloud storage, whatever, I don't wanna be just eating up extra space for no reason for stuff that I'm never gonna go back and look at. Now, because I happen to be into off-road and power sports, I knew that I would come back to some of this footage eventually. So we tried to find a happy medium. Now, where this probably proved the most difficult was in the edit. You've only got 20, 30 seconds tops. I thought to myself, they want 20 seconds, but I'm sure like 27 seconds would suffice. So it came down to picking which shots got to be used. Now, obviously we're wanting to feature a new vehicle and show a lot of the features of that vehicle, like the new tires and David himself, who is the person that we're highlighting here in this 20 second spot. So a lot of the juicy B-roll and the epic mud splash stuff that I love that I initially put into the first cut was removed because, well, it makes sense. We're trying to focus on David for this and his day in the life of being a YouTuber, a crazy mud racing lunatic. So we wanted to feature those things and show a little bit about who he is, where he lives, and what he does during a day in 27 seconds. That's hard to do. So the 60 second was better. So within that 60 second reel, we were able to just extend it a little bit and flex our muscles with a little more B-roll shots, like some drone stuff or the side-by-sides ripping by in the sand with that big trail. Things that didn't necessarily lend to who David was, but showed off the commander more. That was the avenue for this 60 second spot. Now, this video is brought to you by Skillshare. So if you do want to learn more about how to manage clients, how to grow a business, how to succeed as an entrepreneur, there are tons of resources on Skillshare with those topics on top of improving your photography and cinematography. And it's a service that I usually save for these types of videos because I feel like it relates really, really well for people out there wanting to just do it themselves. Skillshare have thousands and thousands of courses for you to choose from, and I like to call it take advantage of, so you can learn as much as possible. Some of the classes that I've showcased in the past are still some of my favorites, like some of the stuff Gary Vee has to offer. You've got really accessible classes like Chris Burkhart teaching mobile photography. Even my friends Caleb and Niles from Moment have an epic course on mobile cinematography. Or if you want to get into scripting and shooting more, you can learn from the master, who is none other than MKBHD, invaluable resources to just make you better. So you know the drill, the first 1,000 people to click the link in the description and pause this video and do it right now, get a month-long free trial of premium Skillshare service. So I highly recommend you do pop. So pause this video, click the link, sign up, do yourself a favor. You'll be super happy you did, and learning is never a bad thing. Now, speaking of that shot where the commander rips by in the sand, there was some footage here, and I think we probably have some raw clips we could show. We had the RS2 set up. I had it all Raven-eyed. I was controlling it from my phone. Kirk hopped in the follow side-by-side. David took off. Kirk took off behind David. David peeled straight out of where we were filming, and within, I don't know, I want to say 15 seconds, sand just full blasted the gimbal and it completely shut off. That was the last shot I ever used that gimbal for. Fully broken, doesn't work, gone, dead, over, the end. So having some sort of contingency plan is probably a good idea for when equipment malfunctions, especially if you're shooting a lot of like rough terrain stuff like off-road. You gotta keep in mind, you're thinking about mud, you're thinking about sand, water, elements, all things that hate camera gear. So this particular interest that I have, I knew would be difficult. So when we packed for this trip, I did bring extra bodies, I did bring extra lenses. I kept them in the bag in the hotel room, but just in case something like this happened and the R5 got destroyed, I could go back and grab my second body and I'd still be fine. If you look at the commander coming up and down these little hills through the forest, some panning shots, using a couple different focal lengths to mix it up and make it feel a little bit different, faster, etc., it worked just fine and I didn't really need the gimbal and I didn't find like I missed it in the edit anyway. Now, one of the biggest challenges of shooting this ad was coming off the heels of just breaking all my fingers. I broke all my fingers, and 2 weeks later, I was in Saskatchewan trying to figure out if I could ride an ATV or a side-by-side with my broken hand, casted fully, and still try to shoot this commercial. So it turned out the answer was no, that didn't happen. So Kirk took the helm, Captain Kirk took the helm of the Defender, the 6x6, and we just crushed in that, used that as our little camera cart, and took things slow. Having him there for that project was imperative because I am one hand down. It just makes everything slower, changing batteries, changing lenses, grabbing gear, holding a camera bag, lifting, like it immobilizes you entirely. So that was a massive challenge throughout this entire shoot, was trying to just balance the whole thing whilst being fully casted. And any type of movement at that point was still aching and throbbing, which I think it was just lots of Advil, right? Just Advil and Tylenol and alternating, and then some White Claw at like 6 p.m. It was a fun shoot. Now, we didn't fill the edit with anything super special transition-wise or fancy. We wanted to keep it to brand for Can-Am. So what we did is we watched every single one of their little vignettes of off-road living that they had made prior, and we tried to keep it in par with what they've already done. So transitions and crazy whip pans and fast in-camera stuff just wasn't going to fly. It needed to blend. It needed to be something that Can-Am would put out, not something that Peter McKinnon would put out. Peter McKinnon can shoot it and make it the best he can in collaboration with Can-Am. So I did spice a few little subtle things in, but it does fit perfectly for their series, which is their Faces of Off-Road. We made lots of revisions to that 20-second ad. The very first one was, I can even tell you, the brand told me it was too fast. There was too many fast cuts. And they said, Peter, we know that's your style and it looks great, but it's just not necessarily how we've done things in the past. It's a little bit too intense. And you guys know, you've seen my style. It usually starts off with something dramatic, and then you're gonna have a cut of music where everything happens, boom, gas. You can kind of feel that moment. You're like, yeah, I've seen, that's classic Peter McKinnon. So they weren't necessarily looking for that to be the vibe of the 20-second thing. And that's perfectly fine, because at the end of the day, we're trying to make them happy. So that was something that was imperative to do beforehand, which is doing your homework. So if you're doing a shoot for a client or any kind of company at all, do your homework. Watch what they've done before. Look up past projects that they've paid other cinematographers or other photographers to make, and figure out what it is that they want exactly. So you don't come in completely changing everything. I don't want to compromise my style. So I still, like I said, sprinkled some of me and Kirk into that edit. But again, it had to blend with their brand. This is, now I talked about this during, are cinema cameras still kind of relevant in 2021? The answer is yes, but I mentioned this briefly. It's always interesting when you show up and you unpack your gear and you're just using a mirrorless camera, a DJI gimbal, and kinda that's it. Not much more. The confidence of the brand could very well at that point be diminished slightly, thinking like, oh, that's it. And I mentioned that in that last video because that also happened during this shoot. I remember the guy running the shoot was like, did you not bring anything else? Shouldn't you put that camera on a gimbal? Or so perception is a funny thing. And it's funny that I just talked about that and that it happened on this shoot, because it's hard to convey to someone that doesn't know you and who's never seen you work. It's okay. Trust me. So I think another key in working for big brands and companies is instilling confidence in them, even if that means you're not showing up with a massive production and a massive crew and huge cameras, because those things instill confidence falsely, because that doesn't mean you're gonna do a good job. But this is the opposite, where like our skills will for sure instill confidence, but maybe the kit that we had doesn't. So probably meeting with the client ahead of time, showing them the gear that you're going to bring, letting them know that this will most certainly get the job done, so that when you show up on set and game day is there, you are ready to go, there is no one thinking, is that gonna be enough? So that was a little behind the scenes look at our shoot in Saskatoon for Can-Am. Hopefully there are a few takeaways there if you are going to be working with brands or you want to work with more brands in the future. If you've got questions about this or things you want me to make another video about with regards to this topic, let me know in the comments below. I'd be happy to continue exploring it so that I can get you out there, or I can help you get out there doing this for a living. And if you're an off-road fan, let me know below, because I might have a channel or something coming. There might be things. You just let me know below. You should do that. You should just say like, yeah, I love those things. Subscribe if you haven't already, and I will see you in the next video. Let's do this old school. Oh man, that just doesn't work anymore. Look at that. It's gotta be like the brim now. It's gotta be the brim.